What on earth am I here for? Is there any purpose for my life? Are there things I'm supposed to be doing? Well, if you've ever asked those questions, you're in the right place, as you have been for the last 6 weeks, as we are in week six of New Hope's What on Earth Am I Here For campaign. As we've been asking those questions, we've learned that in order to get answers to what on earth I'm here for, we need to ask the one who put us here. Because without God, there is no reason, there is no purpose for us. But with God, we discover the reasons and the purposes that we have for living. And we've discovered that there are five. So purpose number one was we were made to be loved. We were put on earth to be loved by God. We're here because God loves us and wants to love us. And our purpose then is to love the God who loves us. So what are the things that we're supposed to be doing? Letting God love us. So this week, anybody find any evidence that God loves you? Anybody feel loved by God this week, anywhere, anytime, someplace, some of you? Yes. So got to slow down, let God love us. Got to slow down, got to talk to God, got to spend time with God. Got to spend time looking at the book as he tells us all the things that he has for us. And do things that make God smile. That's purpose number one, be loved by God. Purpose number two, we were made to belong to God's family. So purpose is to be part of a church. This is called fellowship, where we belong, where we love one another, where we support one another, where we care about one another, where we pray for each other. In this place of belonging, we grow and are supported, loved by God. Sometimes we get crossways with each other. But even when we mess it up, as we follow what it is God's put before us, there are ways through all that and ways to grow. Number three, you remember number three? Created to be great. All right. And God's definition of greatness is to be like Jesus. And this is called discipleship. So our purpose is to grow to become like Jesus, to become like Jesus in the way that he related to God. Become like Jesus in the way that he loves. Become like Jesus in his integrity and in his influence. This is all called discipleship. And growing into that requires that we immerse ourselves in the things Jesus said and did. It requires talking and working with each other in groups as we share and as we figure out how to do this with one another. It requires eating together. Like that. And requires praying. Praying for God to show us how to do this. Praying for God to put this stuff of Jesus in us so that we can become like him. Purpose number four was last week's purpose. Purpose number four was to do good. We were created to do good, created to bless people, created to help people. That's why we're here. So the things that we need to be doing good for people. And the quote that we had from John Wesley was, do all the good that you can, in all the ways that you can, by all the means that you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Right? Y'all remember that? Yeah. Yeah, and you can all repeat it back to me later today. Yeah, so we need to intentionally look for ways to do good. All right, so today, purpose number five, and it's the last one. Are you ready? Drum roll. Okay, here it is. Purpose number five. We were created for mission. Made for a mission. All of us want to go on a mission. All of us want to do something important. We want to do something significant with our lives. We want to make our lives count. God has created us for mission. So what is the mission that God's created us for? What is the mission that God wants to send us on? Well, it has to do with those previous four purposes. The first purpose was to be loved. Do you know anybody that doesn't believe that God loves them? You know, people that feel far away from God? At church camp this past summer, I was talking with a teenage girl. And she said, I've done this terrible thing. And she told me what it was. And on a scale of 1 to the worst thing that a teenage girl can possibly do, it's probably like a 3. she told me what it was, and she said, after doing this, God can't possibly love me. I've blown it with God's love. What am I going to do? And I remember talking with a woman who was in an abusive relationship, abusive marriage, and she said, the reason my marriage is abusive is because God is punishing me. God's angry with me. You know folks like that? They don't feel like they're loved by God. They feel like they've blown it with God. They feel God's angry. My heart goes out to those kinds of people. And there are other people that I know who just don't have time for God. For whatever reason. They're too busy doing the job, doing whatever. Or they're just indifferent. And when I meet those kind of people, my heart goes out to them. Doesn't yours? Don't you want to say something to them? Get them connected to God's love, that God really does love you, that you haven't blown it with God? That there's chance for you? Yeah, well, purpose number two was to belong. Do you know people who don't belong? I mean, not only don't belong to God's family, don't belong to the church, but it seems like they don't belong anywhere. They're alone. They have no one that they can depend on. Nobody who depends on them. Nobody who cares for them. Nobody who cares for them. Nobody who supports them. Nobody they can support. Meet people like this. I meet people like this. My heart goes out to them. Meet people who have grown up in dysfunctional families and they don't know how to trust. They don't know how to have relationships. They get in relationships and they begin to self-destruct. And I want to say to them, here, that's not how it's done. Let me help. My heart goes out to them. Anybody? Yeah, want to do something. Purpose number three was to do good, to be great. Purpose number three was to be great. Have you met people whose definition of greatness is not Jesus, but it's other things? And they spend their whole lives trying to be great in ways that don't have anything to do with Jesus. In our community, I bump into a lot of folks that are in that situation, and my heart goes out to them. In 1 Timothy, Paul writes to Timothy, he says, train yourself to be godly. Physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. I have met a ton of families where dads have spent tens of thousands of dollars, thousands of hours, and have sacrificed the childhoods of their sons and daughters in pursuit of athletic greatness. It's soccer, it's basketball, it's baseball, it's football, it's lacrosse, it's whatever, it's 24/7, wall-to-wall. Now, that's got some value. Some value. But godliness, a ton more value. And I wonder what it would be like if those families, if those dads would take maybe just this much time and train their kids in some godliness to help their kids know that God loves them and that the love is not based on their performance. That the acceptance is not based on how I perform, but I am loved and accepted whether my performance is good or whether it stinks. And that there's forgiveness, that when I mess up, that it's all right, that there's a way to deal with it, and that there's help that's available for the asking. And I just wonder how different life could be for those families and for those kids if those dads could take just this much time and offer some training in godliness. And when I see those families, my heart goes out to them. Don't yours? There's just so much that is missed and it's lost. The fourth purpose is to do good. Have you ever met people whose life is all about me? Not about you, it's about me. It's enough about you, it's more about me. We've spent enough time, it's all me. And everything revolves and focuses around them, and they're miserable. And my heart goes out to them, and I want to say, hey, it's over here what life is about. And there are other people that I meet whose idea of fun and excitement and adventure is self-destructive, and they're a crash waiting to happen. And I want to say, No, no, over here. You know folks like that? Does your heart go out to them? Well, not only does our heart go out to them, but God's heart goes out to them. God wants them to be loved. In fact, He made them to be loved. God made us to belong, and He wants people to belong. And He made us to be like Jesus, and He made us to do good. And when folks aren't involved in those kinds of things, the quality of their lives goes way down. And there is pain and suffering and sorrow that comes their way that just doesn't need to happen. And God's heart goes out to them. In 2 Peter chapter 3, we read, God's not slow in keeping His promise, as some understand slowness. People were talking to Peter about, you know, Jesus said He was coming back. It's been like 25, 30 years. Where is He at? And Peter said, there's a reason He's waiting. There's a reason the sun came up today. And the reason He's waiting is He's patient. He doesn't want anyone to perish. There are people that He's waiting for to repent, to change their lives, to turn to Him, and He wants to give them opportunity. And so the sun comes up every day because there are people that God is hoping that today will be the day that they make the turn. His heart goes out to people. In John 3, 16 and 17, right? God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. He's acting to get folks on board. And Jesus Himself, when He saw the crowds, He had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. So many folks not knowing which way is up, not knowing why they're here, not knowing what on earth their life is about. And Jesus' heart goes out to them. And so what Jesus has done is He has sent us on a mission to reach them. John chapter 20, verse 21. Jesus is with His disciples for the very first time after the resurrection. He lets them touch nail prints in His hand, eats some fish for them, lets them see that He's alive. And then the first thing He says to them is, as the Father sent Me, so I'm sending you. Jesus was sent to seek and to save the lost. He's sending us to seek and to save the lost. Jesus was sent to serve. Jesus is sending us to serve. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon Me, and He's anointed Me to preach good news to the poor. So He wants us to give good news to the poor. He wants us to free the prisoners like He was sent to free the prisoners. He wants us to help the blind get sight like He gave sight to the blind. He wants us to help release the oppressed like He released the oppressed. He wants us to announce that now is the time of God's favor. Now is the time to get help from God. Now is the time to call out from God, because He is just waiting for you to cry so that He can help you. He wants us to be involved in that activity. As the Father sent Me, so I am sending you. That's our mission. Our mission is to bring people to God. This is called evangelism. Okay, so how do we do this? How do we do this? Can I just walk up to somebody on the street and say, hey, do you know the five purposes for your life? If I were to go to Cracker Park, find somebody eating ice cream and say, hey, do you know the purposes for your life? You're not going to get very far that way. So how do we do this? Well, I've got five steps to help us. Number one, pray. In Colossians chapter 4, Paul writes, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. Pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Pray. Who are the people that you know that aren't aware of God's love for them? Who are the people that you know who think they've messed it up so badly that God can't possibly love them? Who are the people that you know that don't belong? Who are the people that you know who think life is all about them? Who are the people that you know who are chasing greatness in ways that have nothing to do with Jesus? Who are the people that you know that are wrecking their lives? Pray for them. Pray for them. Devote yourselves to praying for them. Pray every day for them. God, please help this person. God, please be at work in this person's life. And who are groups of people that you know, that you care about, that you relate to, that maybe there are folks that are messing it up there? Pray for them. Pray for them. And as we pray, Paul says not only pray for them, but pray for an open door. Pray for an opportunity to connect with that person. Pray for an opportunity to talk with that person. Pray for an opportunity to invite that person. Pray that God would open a door in that person's life so that you can do the mission. Pray. All right? Second thing is to enter their world. That's what God did. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. God became a human being. And the literal translation of made His dwelling among us is pitched His tent with us. God moved into the neighborhood. And next to your tent, He pitched His tent. So if we want to reach people, we need to enter their world. We need to go where it is they are. We need to leave our comfort zones and go to where they are and become involved in their lives. For until we become involved in their lives, we don't really have any opportunity to do or to say anything to help them connect with the God who loves them. We have to enter the world. It's not always easy, it's not always comfortable, and it takes time. It takes time. So we've got to enter their world. Okay, the third thing, number three, there it is once we enter their world, in their world, we want to be like Jesus. All the things that we talked about a couple of weeks ago about being like Jesus, having the relationship with God that Jesus has, about loving people like Jesus loves, about having integrity like Jesus has, about having influence like Jesus has. When we enter somebody's world, we want to be like Jesus. We want to love them like Jesus loves. We want to have integrity. We want to bless them. We want to encourage them. We want to support them. We want to lift them up. We want to be kind. We want to be compassionate. All of those things. And then the next thing, number four, is we want to do good. Once they're in their world, we want to do good. We want to look around for how can we help? Where is there an opportunity to do good in this person's life? And maybe it's something as simple as helping them with a task. You know? I can be a gopher. I can help paint the deck. I can help them move. I can help this. I can help that. Once you're in your world, in their world, you'll see where opportunity is to help. And sometimes maybe the help that you can offer is not physical, but maybe it's emotional, and maybe it's supportive. Maybe you'll listen to a problem. Maybe you can offer some resources for whatever problem it is they're dealing with. But look for ways to do good. And as we do that, then there becomes an open door. As we enter the world, as we're like Jesus, as we do good, God opens a door. There's an opportunity. God makes it. It happens. You'll recognize it. Now, what does this look like? How does this work? 6 years ago, moved here. And in the course of moving here, I began to pray about here. Olmsted Falls and surrounding areas, began to pray about the people, began to pray about, God, whose world would you have me enter? Whose life would you have me be involved in? And as I prayed, one of the groups of people that God brought to my mind to be involved in is business people. I like hanging out with business people. Churches that I've served in the past, lots of them are businessmen, businesswomen. So I began praying for businessmen and businesswomen as I came to town. And when I got here, I began to look around for opportunity to enter the world of business people. One of the ways that you can enter the world of business people is the Chamber of Commerce. So I joined the chamber. It cost me a few bucks. And every month, I go to the lunch. And every month, I go to the after-hours stuff that goes on, and I volunteer with some of the stuff that they got going on. I've served on their board. I've entered the world, and I'm there. And I get to know people, and I get to see people. And as I enter the world, I look around for opportunities to be like Jesus and to do good. So one of the things that Jesus tells us to do is welcome the stranger. So I look for brand new people that come to the chamber meetings and make sure I greet them. About 4 years ago, I'm in that world looking for opportunity to do good. There is a new woman who comes in, and I notice that she's working the network thing really hard. She's working hard to meet as many people in that room as she can, and I come up and I introduce myself, and I receive her card and listen to the spiel about her company and the product she was trying to sell, and offer her my card, talk a minute about the church I was serving at that moment, ask how she was doing. She talked to me for a couple minutes, and she went on to the next person, and, you know, I connected. Did a little bit of good, offered her some kindness. The next month, she was at the meeting again. I saw her. I went up, said hello, hey, how you doing? And she said, when can I come out to your church and present my... So, opportunity to do some good. There were some people at that congregation that would benefit from what she had. I said, well, give me a week to talk to some people and get something together. And she just said, okay, and she was off to the next person, and I was talking to somebody else. At the end of that meeting, as I was leaving, went out to the parking lot, got in my car, started to drive across the parking lot, she comes out of the building, flags down my car. I stop, put my window down. She comes up, bends down to the window, and says to me, can you help me connect with the big guy? That's called an open door. And I said, yeah, come Sunday. He's there every week. And she asked again what time the service was and where it was at, and I told her. It took her 2 Sundays to get there. But when she got there, that particular service, she sat way in the back. And I saw her. She came in, and I came in a little bit late, sat way in the back. And after service was over, connected with her for a moment, and her eyes were huge. And she said, you were right. He's here. I said, yeah. And she's back the next week, and the next week, and the next week, working on that connection. And then she met a guy. She started going to church with him. Which is all right. And I continued to see her at chamber meetings, and I talked with her, and she'd tell me about the activities that she was doing at that church. Nothing about the relationship or the connection with the big guy, but about the activities. And I'm thinking, you know, you're not getting what it is you're looking for with this stuff that you're doing. But there wasn't the opportunity in the little one-minute snatches of conversation to extend that conversation and talk about how her relationship was. So I continue being in the world, continue looking for opportunity to do good, continue trying to be like Jesus. And then she disappears. Different job. But I lose track of her for a little more than a year, wondering where she's at. And this winter, I was in Panera, and I saw her. She was by herself. Went up, said hello, we reconnected, found out what she was doing. A couple of months after that, we're getting ready to do the What on Earth Am I Here For campaign. Getting ready to do groups, and I'm thinking about, you know, who can be in my group, and I'm praying to God, you know, I need people to be in my group. Who can I invite? And she was one of the people who popped into my head to give an invitation to. So gave her an invitation, and she replied, would love to come. So she's coming. The first night, we talked about, why are you here? What is it that you hope to get out of this group? And she said, I have a friend who has a real close connection with God, and I've never been able to have that connection with God like she has. Maybe in the course of this group, I can find that. Okay, she's still working it. Another open door here. Week two, she comes. And in week two, you play the video, Rick Warren video, Rick talks to us. And during the course of the week two video, he talks about how to become a follower of Jesus, about how Jesus is our connection to God, about how Jesus died so that our sins can be forgiven, so the obstacles that exist between us and God can be removed, so we can have that relationship with God. And then he invited everyone to pray at the end of the video, a simple little prayer about inviting Jesus into your heart, about asking Jesus to forgive, and about saying, Jesus, I want to follow you. And so Rick led us in that prayer, and he said, when the video's over, if you prayed that for the first time, tell somebody. So when the video was over, I stopped the video, and I just repeated Rick's instruction. If you prayed that for the first time, you know, did anybody pray that for the first time tonight? And she said, I didn't. Party in heaven! Angel parade! Confetti! Cake! In her honor! She finally got the connection. Now, there's a lot more to do, but she got the connection. And how did it happen? She's praying. Entered the business people world. Was trying my best to be like Jesus and to do good with those folks. Looking for opening doors and taking advantage of the open doors when they're there. And as we do that, God works. As we do that, we have opportunity to fulfill the mission for which God created us. Now, it took 4 years. Sometimes it takes a couple of weeks. Sometimes it takes 4 years. Sometimes it takes 20 years. Gail and I worked with her mom for 20 years before she connected. Now, it was complicated and there was a lot of stuff to work through and a lot of things that had to happen. The mission takes time. It takes our time. Weeks, months, years, decades. It takes time. But what else on earth are we here for? To accomplish the mission. And if it takes time to accomplish the mission, God's given us the time to do it. So, made for mission to bring folks to God. Now, as we close out this morning, two questions. The first one is, who are you praying for? Specifically, who are the people that you know that are far from God, that don't know that God loves them, that are doing things to trash their lives, that are pursuing an avenue of greatness that have nothing to do with Jesus, that is going to consume their lives and leave them empty? Who are those people? Who are you praying for? Pray for those folks every day. Whether you have opportunity to connect with them or not, pray for them every day. Because as you pray for them, if you don't have the opportunity, God will create opportunity for somebody else to connect with them. Pray. And pray not only for those particular individuals, but pray and ask God, whose world is it that I can enter? Who would you have me connect with? Who would you have me spend time with? And then as God begins to answer that, the second question is, whose world are you in? Whose world are we in? Where are we spending time? Where is it that we've stepped out of our own world into the worlds of some folks that are in need of the mission that God's called us to? Business people? Is it in the athletic world? In the midst of all that soccer stuff, is there somebody there in the midst of that world for God? Who are the people that God wants you to connect with? What worlds are you in? or what worlds could you be in that contain folks that are far from God, folks that God wants to reach? Whose world are you in? And if you're not in one of those worlds, I encourage you to find one and to hop in and to invest, because that's where the opportunity is going to come for us to live out our mission. Okay? And if we do those two things, the rest of it will follow. But if I'm sitting at home, only talking to my church buddies, I've got no shot at doing the mission. You'd be out there in that world where they are. And as I'm out there and as I'm praying, the rest of it happens. So this morning, let's pray. Let's pray for some folks and let's pray about what world God wants us to be involved in. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this mission that you've given us. It's a hard mission. It's a complicated mission. But it's also one that is exciting and satisfying, and one that allows us to make a huge contribution. We want to be part of that mission. And we want to start this morning, Father, by praying for some folks. So in these moments of silence, the people that you know that are far from God, people that you know that are missing it, that aren't aware of God's love, people that you like to have sitting next to you here in worship, spend a moment and pray for those people by name. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers for these people. And now let's talk with God a moment about what world He would have us get involved in. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers about which world to be involved in. And we ask that you would continue to lead us and guide us into the worlds where you want us to participate. And that you would help us to do good there. And that you would help us to be like Jesus there. And that you would open doors. Please use us in the mission. In the name of Jesus, who sends us, we pray. Amen.